Good afternoon. My name is Pat Quilter, and we're here this afternoon to talk about arguably the first modern superhero, a character that came from the fertile imagination of Edgar Rice Burroughs, probably the most widely recognized superhero on the planet. Literally, billions of people would recognize this character at sight. We're, of course, talking about Tarzan of the Apes, created in 1912 for a pulp magazine audience who was eager for romance and adventure. What you see here on the screen is Lord Greystoke. Tarzan, as you all know, was orphaned as a tiny child and adopted by a family of great apes, unknown to science, sort of a missing link between gorillas and modern humans. They had a rudimentary language, and Tarzan's foster mother, Kala, adopted this little white worm of a baby against over the protests of some of her ape mates. But she slowly raised him, and although he was slow to develop, he eventually gained strength and turned into the adult Tarzan that became the fantasy superhero of the early 20th century. And we see here Tarzan is emerging from, he's being introduced to civilization by his, what will be his closest friend, Paul d'Arnaud, a Frenchman. It's a long story, we can go into more detail later, but he eventually is introduced to civilization, learns to take on the role of a member of the British aristocracy, but is always more comfortable in his native habitat, so to speak. So who is Tarzan? He's more than a simple untutored primitive. He's Edgar Rice Burroughs was widely read in all of the classic mythology of the sort of our Western civilization. So he incorporated a large number of tropes. Now, a trope is something often dismissed as sort of a cliche, but basically it's a phrase or statement like, you know, death and taxes. You know, it immediately creates kind of a body of knowledge in the average person's mind who kind of fills in a part of the story without lengthy explanations. So here is a list of some of the tropes that I've identified as going with this character. And while you think about that for a minute, I'm going to slip out of the thin veneer of civilization and rejoin you.
You're leaving like that? The outfit is casual, but practical.
Get out of my daughter's life and put on some clothes.
Of course, Tarzan was raised without clothing in his original family, so he was always most comfortable with rather minimal clothing on. But let's talk, before we plunge into the artistic side of Tarzan, let's talk about some of the tropes that Edgar Rice wrote. Of course, probably the leading one would be the ugly duckling story. Here's a character kind of growing up in the wrong tribe, initially considered backwards and ugly, but eventually becomes a glorious swan that kind of exceeds the expectations of his family. He grows up in the school of hard knocks, so it's do or die. He's got to survive or perish. And of course, being a fantasy superhero, he survives in style. Prince raised in exile, another classic trope. So a man of an aristocratic heritage who's displaced into one of the, you might say, lowest on the evolutionary scale, and then manages to come back to his original roots. He grows up in the hungry jungle. Just No time for rest. There's hazards on every side. One of the great adventure tropes is the joy of flight. He has this monkey-like ability to go leaping and bounding from one branch to another as he travels through the middle terrace of the verdant tropical jungle, gliding over the tangled underbrush below. And usually at some point in one of the Tarzan stories, one of the other characters gets either carried by Tarzan or possibly kind of rides on its back and gets the thrill of their life swinging through the trees. Now the magic sword is a recurring trope in a lot of legends. That came up in the Viking legend, the Northman. Tarzan finds his father's hunting knife in the ancestral cabin, and that gives him the much needed edge to compete against stronger and stronger foes with bigger teeth. As he begins to grow up, he becomes more aware that he's greatly different than his ape companions. And so he has kind of an identity crisis, but he discovers the picture books in his parents' cabin, and they teach him about, number one is that he is something different, something called an MAN, whereas his tribe mates are APEs, apes. And he actually manages to learn to read to some degree. But eventually a hero comes of age and becomes, comes into his abilities and develops the confidence that he can not just survive but prosper in the jungle. And becomes, of course, one of the great examples of the classic character, goes back to the 17th and 18th century, the so-called noble savage, a well-developed specimen of humanity who's kind of untroubled by our complicated Western moralities and whatnot, and just kind of goes through life. And comfortable in his own skin is another classic. I mean, both literally and figuratively. Literally, because he was raised without clothing in a warm tropical jungle. And figuratively, my theory is that although his ape tribe had a rudimentary language, you never get the sense that Tarzan, has a heavy running narrative in his brain. He sees, he does, so he's got great survival instincts and never seems to be troubled by self-doubt or recriminations. He just carries on. And of course, it's soon enough, he saves the fair princess in the form of Jane Porter, whose party is stranded, amazingly enough, in the very same location where Tarzan's parents were stranded 20 years earlier. And of course, that turns into a classic Beauty and the Beast trope, where we have the fair Jane and the rather bestial Tarzan. There's a lot of exploration of his dual nature. He's, raised as a, primal, warrior animal, yet he's also got good instincts and a sort of British sense of fair play kind of comes into a factor. So, and then there's a fish out of water. It's another trope he burrows frequently, spices up the stories with. Both Tarzan struggling to understand the unwritten rules of civilization and civilized people struggling to get by in the jungle, where he's often ends up having to save them. And Burroughs also has a lot of fun with the observer from afar, the man from Mars syndrome, where Tarzan was not raised in a civilized society where we're kind of trained to avert our eyes from the imperfections and malfunctions of our society. No, he looks straight at everything and pretty much he doesn't tend to provide unasked for criticism, but occasionally compares our people and customs unfavorably with the beast of the jungle that he's grew up with. Here is a magisterial book Tarzan on film, written a few years ago, so I think the very latest film is not in here, but all of the ones up to about 2016 are. So there's Elmo Lincoln, the first Tarzan, 1918, silent movie. Now the book was published in the pulp story came out in 1912. The book version was published in 1914. So being a big hit, the editors demanded more Tarzan stories. So the public was well primed to flock to this movie, and it was, I believe, said to be the first million-dollar hit film. Unfortunately, the man they hired to play Tarzan was called away to be in World War I, so they had to fall back on Elmo Lincoln, who was, let's say, barrel-chested, but not necessarily what Edgar Rice Burroughs had in mind as the ideal Tarzan figure. However, the movie's kind of stolen by young Gordon Griffith, the 10-year-old, plays 10-year-old Tarzan, mostly in the nude, discreetly shot from the rear and so forth, but eventually obtains clothing. This is Kamuela Searle, the son of Tarzan, which was the third book in the series, who also sort of stole the show from Elmo Lincoln. In the late 20s, Tarzan became fairly overdressed for some reason. And how about those leopard skin shorts and over the shoulder? But here we come to probably the most beloved of the Tarzans, Johnny Weissmuller, who went on to make 12 movies, well past his prime, I must say. But you know, had a winning personality and was a very handsome fellow and is still, in many people's minds, the definitive movie Tarzan. Even though he contributed at least three major Hollywood errors to the Tarzan mythos. He speaks in broken English, whereas once Tarzan was introduced to civilization, he became quite fluent. He swings on vines, which was a practical necessity because, nobody could figure out how to film in it. A person leaping and springing from branch to branch like you was described. And that yell, I'm sorry, it's very recognizable, but it is not anything like I would imagine the victory cry of the bull ape to be, which Burroughs never described in any more words than that. But and there's, of course, Maureen O'Sullivan as Jane, who was also greatly beloved. They hired Buster Crabb to do a competing Tarzan movie by RKO Studios, whose rather skimpy loincloth wins the Best Cheeks Award. Herman Brooks was personally selected by Burroughs in 1935, and they made a Tarzan chapter play or serial, which was, as such things were generally, rather cheaply produced, but he was of the kind of lean and sinewy school of Tarzan characters. Now we're back to Johnny getting a little later in his career and kind of growing into his role. Here's a one movie oddball, Glenn Morris. MGM had the rights to do remakes, so they tended to do repeat series, and then we got Tarzan and Boy. Of course, the average librarian doesn't know that Tarzan and Jane were properly married at the end of Volume 2, but they were never shown to be married in the movies, so they couldn't have be shown to be having a natural son. That would be out of wedlock. So they had to find a boy, who survived a plane crash. And so Johnny Sheffield becomes a accessory to Tarzan. Here we have a scene for Tarzan. In 1943, of course, in the middle of World War II, this Princess Zandra is pleading with Tarzan to come save her village from the Nazis who are parachuting in to steal all their rare minerals. And Tarzan's basically like, nah, it's not my problem. You know, they're not bothering me, you know. But finally, he gets knocked out by them. And while she's nursing him back, he says, where is boy? And she says, they took him. Nazis take boy? Now, Tarzan, make war. And the theater erupts in cheers. meanwhile, Johnny is continuing to kind of grow into his role, shall we say. Eventually he did retire, and so Lex Barker took over the role in the early 50s and was kind of nondescript, but, you know, did it. And then they hired this Gordon Scott guy, who was an actual bodybuilder type. And he eventually, his last couple of movies, they finally scripted him to speak proper English, and he was kind of a, you know, fully aware, you know, almost a James Bond type. And a couple of those films are actually have decent adult plots and with, you know, psychological drama and whatnot. They've got Sean Connery as one of the villains, who they wanted to take over. The producer, Cy Weintraub, said, you know, I'd like to have you take over the Tarzan role when Gordon Scott got tired of it. And he said, well, you know, I would, but they want me to do this spy movie thing. And and so we know where that went. Then another one shot Tarzan, Denny Miller. And there's, I can never keep, it's either Jock Mahoney, I think, or Ron Eli. I always get them kind of mixed up. And Mike Henry did several. He was a football player, so he could, and I think that's Ron Eli. He did the TV series in 66, 67. There's the Filmation Saturday morning animated Tarzan, which probably tried the hardest to actually use stories from Edgar Rice Burroughs, but on account of the rigid standards for children's TV, he can't even wear a knife. I mean, he can't do or have anything on him that some little kid might try to imitate and get hurt. So it was very, very watered down. But then the infamous Bo Derek Tarzan, who what's the guy's name? Miles something. He never speaks in the movie, but he looked good, and so did Bo, of course. Then we kind of, the whole, you know, series began to kind of run out of steam. But in 1984, we had the Greystoke Legend of Tarzan, which is where you saw those origin story photos earlier on. So probably the first part of that movie will no doubt be the best film ever of him growing up in the ape tribe. The second half, they kind of wander far off the story, and it turns into kind of a tragedy. This Joe Lara guy did a TV movie and a one season TV series, and was, you know, he got the character, and he was, he had martial arts skills, so he moved well, which is something a lot of the, you know, beefy type Tarzans just kind of clunk around. They don't, you know, they don't have the kind of, you know, agility you would expect. And then that's Wolf Larsen, another TV series guy. And Casper Von Dien, a rather forgettable 98 movie. And then Disney came along and made a very good cartoon, which we'll go into in a little more detail. But although, you know, it's very cartoony, they got a lot of the aspects of the character quite well. And it's a very heartfelt series, and Disney at the top of their game. So, you know, it's a wonderful piece. Another sort of weird forgotten byway, they try to get Travis Fimmel to do Tarzan, gets extracted from the jungle by his greedy capitalist relative, brother or something, because he owns a third of the shares of Greystoke Industries, and they need control. And so he's captured and brought to New York and kept in this kind of giant terrarium, but he escapes and meets Jane and, yada, yada, yada. But it was kind of a mess plotting-wise, although it had some steamy moments. This is an oddity, a motion capture computer animated Tarzan from Germany in 2013, which I'll have a few clips from later. An interesting effort, and one that is a good, interesting contrast to the hand-drawn Disney animation. So we'll go into that. And then the last Tarzan movie of 2016 was Alexander Skarsgård, who did a six-month training program to get sort of bulked up as Tarzan, who managed to play almost the entire movie without even cutting his britches down into shorts, let alone getting into a loincloth. So it was a little bit lacking in fan service there. But so that was a survey of Tarzan on film. Now we will look at Tarzan art for pulp magazines. So again, this is yet another one of the coffee table books that that should be in the reference library. So this is the 1912 cover painting for the first publication of Tarzan of the Apes. So you notice it says at the very bottom, A Romance of the Jungle. So they were always considered to be what my mom would have called steamers, you know. I mean, you know, very, you know, not explicit by modern standards, but this, you know, setups were quite clear, and you know, there were heaving bosoms and stalwart men, you know, rescuing fair maidens and all of this. Just the thing for, you know, office weary Americans toiling away in their office cubicles. So here's volume two, The Return of Tarzan. A lot of these paintings are by an artist named Alan St. John, who came from a kind of a, you can see sort of a vaguely fine arts tradition. And it's interesting to see how the image of the, you know, perfect male body evolves over the years. You know, it starts out, you know, rather modest in physique, and by the time we get to the later period, you know, it's a totally, you know, fantasy. This is a rarity. It's an interior illustration showing Tarzan with a beard, which was definitely not in character. Burroughs went to a lot of trouble to have him not have a beard because he wanted a clean cut ape man. So he actually has Tarzan figure out how to shave himself with his father's hunting knife because he fears that he's turning into an ape by getting all hairy. And and a lot of the titles for these pulp publications were changed for the book publication, in case there's anybody here keeping notes. But you can see that the artwork's kind of, you know, progressing as we get into the 20s. This is Tarzan with graying temples, another development that was eventually kind of pulled back because he gets immortality pills from a native witch doctor at some point in the series. So Burroughs can continue to write stories about a man of perpetual youth. As we go along, you can see that, you know, we're kind of getting more into the, what we would kind of call the modern fantasy version of Tarzan. But all of these magazines, you know, were originally like 10 cents and we're now up to 25 cents in, I think, around 1930. But they were, you know, cheap entertainment in an era where, except for maybe movies, and eventually they started having radio shows, but especially before radio and, you know, 10 cents and you got a week's worth of lurid fantasy stories, adventures, westerns, you know, jungle stories, whatever. To keep yourself entertained. And they had interior illustrations in, you know, pen and ink, and then the covers were always in full color to attract the eye. And one time Burroughs managed to place a story in a so-called slick, a magazine on the level of the Saturday Evening Post, as with, you know, glossy paper instead of the pulp magazine, you know, newsprint paper. So the art for that was a little more sophisticated. And that's my takeout image for this segment. So now we go to the book cover art. So the now they, you know, once they went to novel production, of course they had a bigger art budget, so the covers tended to be more lavish. Now this image was, I believe, painted by Alan St. John. So that's what you'd see on the front of the book. That's the entire dust jacket. But for publication, it was turned into this very iconic silhouette. When this image is familiar to any aficionado of Tarzan. Initially, again, we see images that were very much from the early 20th, late 19th century art tradition. Almost, you know, something you'd imagine from a, you know, classical artist of some kind. But as we went along, you know, we gradually get more into what we would now probably call something resembling fantasy art. Now the books, of course, were frequently republished, often with a brighter, more striking covers in a lower priced edition after the, you know, first edition run their course. So we get a second series of images and third and fourth and fifth and sixth as the years went by. They had a long publication history, probably still in print. Well, they are still in print. So here, now we're getting into what I think of as sort of the modern era. It's probably about 1970. So we're looking at some of the works by famous artists like Frank Frazetta. There's another guy, Boris Vallejo, who had a similar style. And, you know, they're creating a more photorealistic impression while, you know, providing these, you know, glorious, fantasy images of Tarzan having, you know, one adventure after another. One of my personal favorites, he's looking at the lost city of a lost Roman Empire city, but just the way he's kind of casually hanging on to a branch over, you know, bottomless precipice of some kind, it just kind of shows how comfortable he is moving around in the dangerous terrain. If you ever wanted to read just one Tarzan book and you're not familiar with them, this would be a good choice. It's from the latter half of the series. So Burroughs had a little bit of a technical problem as a writer. After getting Tarzan and Jane married, and then they had a son and this and that, after a few books, there wasn't much more he could do with Jane around. She became kind of a, you know, hindrance to him. So she got kind of quietly edged off stage. She would stay back in London while Tarzan would return to Africa on one mission or another and get into various kinds of scrapes. And the other thing about that is that Tarzan remained faithful to Jane, even though he was importuned by a number of hot babes over the years. And but it gave him a reason not to, engage in, you know, premarital sex, which would have gone against the the decency codes that were either explicitly or implicitly used in these publications. So so Tarzan in the City of Gold, he encounters the Mad Queen Nemone, who is tremendously hot for him, but she's basically psychotic. And so she has these, one moment she'll be, throwing herself at his feet. The next moment she'll be calling for the guards to, take him to the pit, but there's some wonderful, kind of frank dialogue and whatnot. And it's a good adventure. There she is. She has a guardian lion, who doesn't like Tarzan for some reason. And these are just kind of a collection of different artists' impressions of what Tarzan would have looked like. Of course, there's certain commonalities, but they tended to have their own idea of what to do with the face and head. He was always described as very handsome, although he had a kind of a scar across his forehead from one of his early fights that he almost lost, and which would turn red when he was angry, so sort of like a barometer of his mood. This is a later adventure. He's parachuting into another lost empire. All the time fighting one thing or another. This was one of the last book stories written in the middle of World War II, and he's serving as John Clayton, a British colonel, as an observer on an American reconnaissance flight that shot down over Sumatra. And so they all have to parachute out. And there's the classic World War II movie cross-section of America. There's the guy from Brooklyn, there's the Chicago guy, you know, there's all these men. And then this Limey, who turns out to be Tarzan after, and of course the jungles of Sumatra are hot and steamy, so he's quickly gets right at home takes a while for the other folks to figure out who he really is. But there's a number of cases in the books that are sort of self-referential where somebody in the book, well, you're Tarzan? I thought you were just a fiction, you know, just made up, you know. So they have fun with that. One thing I always like to look at, you know, his feet were supposed to be, you know, I mean, a human foot can only do so much, but having grown up with apes whose feet are almost like second hands, you know, the toes should be active and prehensile, not just, you know, passively sticking there, but kind of always trying to get a grip on things. So that's a better than average example of a Tarzan's foot. But we have a few more here. This is kind of fun. So here's I guess it's either graphite or pen and ink, but it was colorized for a book cover. So kind of a good example of what difference color makes. That was, amazingly enough, there on this uncharted, no, actually, Tarzan and the Castaways, it's another late novel where they end up on the proverbial uncharted island where there's a lost Mayan empire. And so that was book covers. Now we get into comics. So, and especially in the form of the modern graphic novel, it's probably safe to say that the comic format gave artists the greatest liberties and freedom to, you know, show Tarzan in his, you know, most fantastic possible manner. So we kind of lead off. But there's a long early history of Tarzan started out being shown in newspaper funnies. Now, back in the day, in the 20s, newspaper comic sections were sections, not just a couple of pages, and often two sections. The only thing in the paper that would ever be printed in color, only on Sunday, and they gave entire pages to their popular titles. So a typical Tarzan Sunday comic would take up a whole newspaper page like you see here. The artist that started out drawing Tarzan was the name will come to me in a minute, the same one who went on to do Prince Valiant, Hal Foster. And so he did Tarzan for a while, and then he decided to do his own material, Prince Valiant. So, but there's a Hal Foster, typical Hal Foster frame. So taking over was a, it'll come to me, but you know, the Tarzan, you know, became, as the years went by, we get a little more modern in terms of the you know, the imagery and depiction. So this, now we're into the 60s and 70s. So we're kind of gotten to what you would think of as classic Dell comic book type renditions of the character in all their lurid color. But now we get to the actual comic books. So the earliest comic books of the 30s were collections of Sunday funnies printed, you know, on smaller paper. And oftentimes, a comic book had a series of different characters in it, Tarzan and several others. This Sparkler comic, you can see it has, you know, a whole roster of people, including Nancy. That's a character that goes way back. This is around early 1940s, they were beginning, and of course, what's interesting is they weren't embarrassed to show, you know, blood and gore back then. Tarzan can be seen, you know, stabbing and killing with blood dripping off his knife, something you would never see in later Legion of Decency renditions. But at some point we begin to get actual, you know, stories drawn for comics, not lifted from the newspapers. So here we are in a Dell comic in the 10 cent era. Now for a long time they ran actual photos from Hollywood Tarzans on the covers instead of cartoon covers. I'm having a little fun here, but of course there's also this early 50s, there was a period of moral panic when a couple of muckrakers in Congress decided that they could win points by pointing out all the evil, wickedness present in comics if you just look close enough. So they had to kind of tame things down. And so there was a comics code came in. It was just similar to the movie code of the mid-30s, which also was driven as much as anything by Jane and Tarzan's skimpy outfits of especially their second movie. So Tarzan, you know, marches on through the 60s and 70s in comic form. But at some point, Marvel takes over. So Marvel, of course, was a kind of rev things up to a higher level. Of course, famously invented all kinds of new superheroes. But Tarzan was one of their titles for a while. And so they put their talented artists to work and started cranking out. It looks like mostly we're talking about essentially comic book renditions of some of the famous Burroughs stories. And then there became kind of a lull or a dark era in the 80s. Nobody wanted to really see Tarzan. And when it came back, it was a very different time. So these Malibu Comics people have their have this very dark vision of Tarzan, I don't know what kind of drugs are on here, but they did put out one good title, actually several, but this one was from the early 90s. It shows Tarzan in San Francisco. He and Jane are living under new identities because they have to, quote, die every generation or so because they've got the immortality pills, and you know, people will get suspicious if they just don't seem to be aging. So at some point they kind of slip away and fake their deaths and start over again under new identities. So they're living in San Francisco. Jane is fighting ivory importers because they're decimating the elephant herds in Africa. And Tarzan aficionados will know that Tarzan always had a close relationship with elephants. They were their friend, their big, big, steady powerful friend. So they have some fun with Tarzan in civilization. Here he is going to, another one of Burroughs' great inventions was the so-called hollow earth. Imagine the earth was kind of like a tennis ball, and the inside was a whole nother land with a kind of a central ball of incandescent gas serving as a interior sun. And the deal there being that it's a land without time. The sun never moves, so there's no day or night. Things happen. People know that there's a before and after, but there's no measure of time. Nobody really ever worries about clocks or days. They just kind of measure things by so many sleeps between this and that. This another pretty good graphic novel treatment. This is Tarzan in the drowned world of the future, post sea level rise, and everything's gotten, you gotta have your gas mask handy because you never know when you're gonna run into toxic waste or something bubbling up from a buried, flooded out laboratory or whatever. They have some fun with that, with all these drowned world images. And crossovers, Tarzan and the Planet of the Apes, which I've read like twice and I still can't figure out what the story really is, but it looks good. Joe Jusco is a current fantasy artist who specializes in Burroughs material, and including Tarzan. And probably, the leading current artist in a sort of a photorealistic fantasy art style. Now the amazing thing about I find about these are all done on about a 9x12 inch painting. I mean, how he gets the level of detail he gets at that small of a scale, I'm just amazed, as an observer. But he has a wonderful series of different images. The apes have a monthly dance they call the Dum Dum, where they pound on the ground with sticks and dance under the light of the full moon. So here's Tarzan participating in the Dum Dum, and various other action poses. Now here, in my opinion, that's overwrought Tarzan. I mean, he was always described by Burroughs as not Hercules but Apollo. So built more like a gymnast or a swimmer like Weissmuller. Looks strong, but he's actually stronger than he looks. But he's all about agility and quick reflexes. Prefer a slightly less overwrought Tarzan, maybe along, here he is in an arena battle in the lost city of Rome. And there's that image you saw of the Mad Queen and her guardian lion. Once again, saving the damsel. Useful safety tip. Never put your hand in the jaws of a toothy creature. And here he is ripping the bars off a jail cell. That to me is your kind of classic Tarzan image, well built, but not every vein showing. So since we're here to talk about art, I prepared a segment on Disney's rendition of Tarzan. Now they spent, as they do, a lot of time thinking about the character. They went and visited gorillas in Africa. Absorbed the look and feel of the jungle. But one of the great achievements is that even though the Tarzan figure they ended up with is very cartoony, he has an anatomy. and you can see the muscles under the skin. So the character breathes from within, even though it's still a cartoon. They actually hired an anatomist. Thank you. So the cartoon Tarzan was always built from the inside out, so to speak. The results were, of course, like I say, cartoony, but, you know, they had a lot of fun with the, prehensile feet and they kind of characterized him. They figured anyone that had survived, you know, this long in the jungle and was now a young adult had to be a bit of a punk, you know, so they gave him kind of a little bit of an attitude. Now this is about a 2-minute piece of one of their staff artists drawing Tarzan. And as students of art, I'm sure you'd appreciate the skill of being able to start from scratch, and within a couple of minutes you'll see, you know, the recognizable Tarzan that they used in the cartoon. And they gave Tarzan now they had him growing up with gorillas, which was not technically correct in terms of Burroughs created a fictional sort of missing link tribe of apes who were more upright than gorillas and did have a rudimentary language. For whatever reason, Disney decided to have him hang out with gorillas. So he does a lot of knuckle walking and crouches a lot, which does give an opportunity to create a sense of coiled strength and, you know, character basically ready to kind of pounce on whatever may be passing by. But I'm just, you know, amazed at, you know, a few little pencil strokes and suddenly we've got, you know, eyes and a nose and kind of come along here. Signature. Just amazing. So this was the pitch reel, a series of quick sketches arranged into a presentation that's about a minute and a half. You'll notice, you know, the character development is quite different than what they ended up with. Heading in a slightly more realistic direction than the cartoony look they ended up with. But I thought it was an interesting example of how, you know, the artist basically convinced management to support this movie. The hair in particular, they apparently had a lot of trouble deciding what to do with the hair, and they finally saw some kid skateboarder with dreadlocks and said, ah, there's our look. So the final Tarzan ended up with the ropey dreadlocks. So so that's what we ended up with. Interesting contrast. Now this is early, one of the great technical achievements of the cartoon was this 3D digital canvas. So they had a name, I think that's what they called it. Basically a 3D rendering of limbs and branches that their staff artists could paint on, like just, you know, like it was a, like any other surface. So that was a famous a pencil shot of Tarzan doing a here they're just showing how they can kind of zoom around inside this 3D structure, and then one of their pencil artists I think he probably did this overnight or something, drew an example of Tarzan, you know, leaping and bounding through this structure and ending up on it. And this, of course, turned into this sequence of the movie. There's a montage in the middle where he changes from a boy to a man, and here he is kind of in the last stages of that evolution. But, you know, I find that, you know, I appreciate that because, first off, it shows his, you know, he's always described as having a tremendous joy when free to, you know, bound through the trees. And he's breathing, you know, the character lives. Now, compare that to this is that motion capture animation done about 13 years later. So, same, you know, they obviously had sort of the same general idea, and they were able to, you know, probably using a parkour artist for the motion capture and then mapping it into a computer animated figure. So this maybe is close to a, you know, a quasi live action rendition of what Tarzan is supposed to be able to do, but I'll have one comment at the end. Basically, you know, the motions are all great, but, you know, the character is just a kind of a rubber bag. It doesn't breathe from within. You know, it's like a, you know, rubber skin around a robot or something. You don't see the muscles working, you don't see the chest inflating, you know, but they have a lot of fun with the action. That was sort of teenage Tarzan before. Now he's finally reached his full growth. I have more, but maybe this would be a good time to take questions or whatever. I don't know how we're doing on time.
I'm curious as to what you feel is the most accurate or best, the image that best represents the author's depiction or vision.
Probably, you know, those, the images from the like the, you know, kind of modern fantasy artists, Joe Jusco and those people. But one of the things that the fan base complains about justifiably is that, you know, Burroughs, you know, his imagination was that, you know, it was supposed to be an ape man, you know, that here's someone that grew up, you know, red in tooth and claw, you know, thinks, you know, his instinctive fighting style is to, you know, lunge for the throat and try to rip out your jugular. And, you know, that sort of thing has never been shown, at least in motion film. You know, Disney captured the Tarzan's, you know, joy of life, but watered down the violence for kids. The Hollywood pictures were, you know, physically unable to show Tarzan doing the things he's supposed to be able to do, and generally also tended to shy away from the more gory things. I mean, Tarzan is all the time, you know, killing a deer or a boar or something and slicing a big slab of meat off the haunch and chowing down with blood running down his chin, you know. I mean, and you know, the Johnny Weissmuller, you know, rendition of Tarzan is basically what I call the alabaster statue theory of, you know, you have a male sex symbol who's, you know, supposed to be kind of scary and, you know, unpredictable, but he's hairless, you know. I think they were required to have Brazilian wax jobs or something because until they did Mike Henry much later in this, Tarzan never really had any hair on his chest. So yeah, the bestial side of Tarzan has not ever really been well captured. Physically speaking, you know, there's no doubt, you know, a fair selection of bodybuilder types who could look the role, but not all of them can move like you would hope.
Just one more question. Do you foresee any future depictions? Have you heard anything? I mean, you follow Tarzan?
As a matter of fact, yeah, there is a great hubbub in the Burroughs verse right now of Sony has taken out an option to do a Tarzan, one or more Tarzan movies. Something I should mention in passing. Edgar Rice Burroughs was a pioneer in incorporating himself. In I think 1923, he created the Edgar Rice Burroughs Inc. Corporation in order to be able to, you know, have a business that could not only, you know, be, you know, use it, you know, hire himself as a writer, so to speak, but publish books and make movies and whatnot. So to this day, there is an Edgar Rice Burroughs Incorporated office in Tarzana, California, and you can, and of course that city got its name from Edgar Rice Burroughs buying a ranch there back in the days when the valley was still mostly open land, and it was called Tarzan, and he naturally called it Tarzana. He made a lot of money from his writing career. I mean, for the day, I mean, a lot of money. Unfortunately, some of it, you know, he tried to start a golf club, which didn't go, a country club, which didn't go anywhere, and that drained a lot of money. But, writers are not always the best stewards of their money. But
I was going to say, I've noticed at the beginning when they kept having films, different films come from different companies almost simultaneously. You know, you never see that anymore.
I haven't really spoken to this, and it's probably, we should say something about it. You know, unfortunately, the character in some respects has not aged well. In 1912, America was a country of complacent white supremacy. You know, Europeans dominated the world, had colonies all over, you know, the third world countries. You know, their older colonies in South America and North America had broken free, but had been colonized centuries before. And, you know, so it was just the way things were. And Burroughs was writing for a white audience reading pulp magazines, you know, and writing these fantasy adventure stories. So, you know, he was writing in a racist time, and some of his characterizations definitely feel racist by today's standards. He himself was probably not a racist in a personal sense, but he lived in that milieu. And even in the 30s, in the, you know, in the Weissmuller movies, there's going to be a moment where somebody draws a bead on Tarzan because they think he's going to harm Jane or something. And she'll say, "You can't shoot him. He's a white man." Yeah, like it's okay to shoot somebody else, you know. You know, the character is difficult to portray today because you know, you can't really have him, you know. First off, Burroughs never went to Africa. His whole vision of Africa was completely made up. So the deepest, darkest Africa with, you know, tropical jungles and teeming with lions and you know, other wildlife and cannibal tribes and, you know, lost civilizations and whatnot, you know, that was all basically made up. And as part of the, you know, times in which he lived, you know, Tarzan generally ended up being sort of the white savior of somebody or something from generally some degenerate tribe of either Africans or oftentimes beastmen or some other, you know, lowlife from one of the lost worlds. So those elements of the Tarzan mythos are tricky today. Now, you'll notice in 2016, they finessed this by having him go with, you know, an African-American actor to Africa to stop the atrocities of King Leopold of in the Belgian Congo. So there's fighting on the side of the oppressed blacks. But even then, it's still, you kind of have this awkward, you know, white savior parachuting in and you know, right. So yeah, what is the future for Tarzan? It's very difficult. The fan base is in a big uproar because somebody somewhere said that Sony is thinking of, quote, reimagining the character, which sends chills down all their spines. The problem is the character's always been reimagined. It's never really been portrayed, certainly in live action film, as anything really close to what Burroughs imagined. That 1935 movie with Herman Brix came, you know, tried hard, but it was, you know, low budget production, terrible sound quality, which kind of impairs the enjoyment of the movie, you know, shot in Guatemala, so it had interesting, you know, exotic scenery, but at the same time, difficult production difficulties, so film quality isn't always that great and whatnot. And, you know, at the end of the day, you still got, you know, an inability to show Tarzan really doing, you know, the kind of physical stunts that he's supposed to be able to do.
I just want to say, in reality, too, you can't swing from those vines in general.
You actually, well, you know, I will contradict that. When I was in Hawaii, which I went to high school there, so I go back for my high school reunions, I made a little trek up the old Pali Highway, and there's jungle on both sides. And there's all these half inch thick vines hanging down, no thicker than my thumb. And I swung on them. Yeah. They would hold me. So yes, it does seem to strain the imagination that they'd be conveniently placed, ready to go from one tree branch to another and then pick up the next one and keep going. But they are strong and flexible. So that per se wasn't necessarily unrealistic, but he's supposed to be able to run out at the tour where a limb was springy enough to kind of bound and then catch the next one, maybe grab a vine on the way there and whatnot. But, you know, use his the abilities he learned growing up as he got heavier and heavier to understand, instinctively know what limbs would bear his weight and whatnot.
I'd love to hear from the students here how you think you might make Tarzan a more contemporary woke character, because it strikes me as a very challenging thing to do. Could he speak to your world and your values?
I think so. I don't really think it'd be that hard, to be honest. I mean, hey, you
want, you introduce yourself?
Sorry.
Hayley's doing superheroes from different, from what, the Aztec culture?
From Aztec, yeah.
So she's, she has a little interest in superheroes.
Well, I don't feel like it would be that hard to do it. I mean, obviously, if you were to say, if you're trying to make like Tarzan and Anna today, and just, you know, the story being he's abandoned in the jungle and, you know, raised by apes and such, I really don't think so, because I feel like Tarzan is more at its, he's pure. He's raised by animals that do not have any form of prejudice. So it's mainly just survival. And there is also like a love for his own environment. So he doesn't know the whole white man, you know, black man, or however any other skin type. He sees a man or he sees a woman, he just thinks, those are my people. So I really think that's what's different about Tarzan.
Yeah, he emphasizes his relationship
with
the apes too. Like,
yeah.
He feels
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Those are excellent observations, and right out of the books, if you, you know, as it, when you soak up the story as a whole, yeah, he's definitely his own creature. He does not distinguish the categories we traditionally judge people by. He looks to their actual characters, and, you know, incidentals like skin color and hair type, you know, don't mean anything to him per se. And yes, and he's, you know, especially in the later, you know, adaptations, he's become an environmentalist who wants to preserve the jungle and its wildlife, and has always been kind of skeptical of civilization as being, you know, artificial and tending to produce, you know, various forms of skullduggery.
I agree. I feel like in many ways he is one.
And if I was to recommend, you know, I would say Tarzan discovering some sort of lost civilization would be one way to have an adventure that doesn't particularly involve, you know, interracial conflicts or that sort of thing. And I even wrote an amateur screen treatment, which I sent into one of the fanzines for that City of Gold movie that I like, book that I like.
Thank you, Pat. So.